patient's reliability, this is what we were talking about yesterday when I said informant. That basically means you can chart. Patient is a poor historian. Meaning, because you're going to be at the ER. Let's say you're on the CARDS team or neurology team. You're going to go down to do that full H&P. Oh, Joe Blow there is just drunker than a skunk. How are you going to do it? You got to do a full H&P on him. You have to get the information. So what you do is you put in there, patient is incapacitated secondary to intoxication or drug, whatever. And then you have to get his charts or get any information you can. You go try to pull a family member out. You got to get that information. So you will learn ways of doing it. You can pull anybody into it, but you have to document. Patient incapacitated wife, better name, provided me with the information that is in this HMP. Get it? Just document who it was. Because again, if you have a 2-year-old, you have to say, mother or father or caretaker provided me with the information in this document. Okay? This last one, remember this, interpreter. This is huge, huge. You're going to have lots of instances where you have patients that cannot speak English or you don't speak their language. You have to get the information from them. You have to get an interpreter somewhere. Most hospitals will provide you one via this cool little screen or this weird telephone that you pick up and it's bizarre. Or a person will, you know, be an interpreter for you. You have to document that. Because if you ever have an issue with a language barrier and something bad happens to that patient secondary to and you didn't document that an interpreter was there, they can sue you and say, why you were not, you did not do what you should have done to be able to communicate with that patient appropriately. Document there's an interpreter. Okay. So that's what identification is right there. It's just a one-liner, but all that stuff can go in there. Chief complaint, we've already talked about this. This is basically, this is what I'm here for today. I wrote this here for you because, again, I don't want you to think all reasons people come to you are urgent, acute, symptom. It can be to establish care. What if it's just to establish care? How do you put that? Well, guess what? You can say presenting to establish care. You can say that. Don't ever say no problem. Don't ever say. I think that was not correct grammar. Sorry. Chief concern, that's not on here, but again, because that's kind of a new thing we're getting into, which I told you, cool with that. Included if it's applicable. If someone's coming to us present just to establish care, and they're just happy as a clam, there's not going to be a chief concern, right? I got trouble for saying that once. There's not always going to be a chief concern. Not all, you know. It is okay. Don't dig for it if they're just sitting there presenting for care. It's like, give me those things. Just bothering you. You look sad. It's just if it's applicable. Okay? It's applicable. And you're going to do a lot of training on that chief concern because it is unbelievably important. It is. And we'll teach you how to do that. Some of you will already be able to do it. History of present illness. I know we've talked about this one to the point you're probably like, move on, Andy. Even on page 20, it gives you their version of what we did, the Big Eight. And if you look on page 21, the table 2-2, is our version the same? Or our book's the same somewhere? Okay, good. I'm just making sure because mine's from when I graduated. There's their mnemonics for getting the HPI. There's many different ways of doing it. That's why I told you not to freak out and be like, well, we saw it this way. There's a million different ways to gather it. But it's the same, basically. One thing, totally random, I was thinking about this last night when I was laying in bed. When I told you about body location, like where's the pain at, One question I always ask to follow up with that, does it radiate anywhere? I may or may not have said that, and if I didn't, write that down. Okay, good. I always ask, does pain move anywhere? Does it radiate? I always ask that. So you're probably sitting here thinking, well, Andy, how do I develop an HPI if they're just coming to establish care? Just write in there. Patient is a pleasant 35-year-old male, presents today to establish care. Patient was previously under the care of Dr. John Smith in Oklahoma City for the last 2 years, period. Patient has no complaints today, otherwise healthy, period. I mean, that's okay, you can just write that. You don't have to make up a story. Past medical history, again, I know Nikki already went through this with you. Past medical history contains all those other boxes underneath it. And there's like a little table 2-3 shows all the stuff that goes under past medical history. Now, on your EMR, you might actually have, you will, there won't be just a past medical history box and then blank. It'll actually have PMH. There'll be a box for family history, social history. So if you can't go wrong, you don't have to memorize. I mean, it's all going to be there for you. It just prompts you, fill in the family history box now. Fill in the gynecological box now. Most EMRs, they already have it for you there. Oh, if Nikki didn't, I apologize for not sitting in on her lecture, if she did or did not. One thing I always do on past medical history, and it's really good when you do an admit H&P, you always list out the right diabetes, hypertension, this is what they told me they have. I always put stable, uncontrolled, or resolved. So if you have a diabetic and you put that as number one on their past medical history under, you know, health conditions, I'll just put a little dash and I'll put stable or hypertension dash uncontrolled. And you ask them, obviously that's why, like, are you controlled or is your diabetes, blood sugar is 400 every day. You know, you ask them, they'll tell you. That's just good care. It's just a little thing I do. Okay, yeah, medical, surgical, hospitalizations, medications. You always want to list their medications. You'll learn the little pearls for pulling information out of people because you're going to get this one a lot. You'll say, you have any major medical issues as an adult? They'll say, health is a horse. Okay. Go on down to the medications box. You're like, are you on any meds? Yes, I am. I'm on lisinopril. I'm on metformin. I'm on ACTZ. I'm on Zoloft. And you'll be like, thought you were healthy. They just don't associate that as. So that is when you'll jump back up to that box and you'll say, okay, what do you take your Zoloft for? You know, so you'll have to fill it in. You can go back. Not a big deal. So if I, that's what I was going to say. I'll ask a person, do you have any major medical issues as an adult? And they'll say, no. I'll say, do you take medications for anything? And that's when they'll be like, oh, yeah, I take. Allergies, important. Always document the name of the medication and be sure and document what the allergy is. I don't know if Professor Brooks said that to you or not. Extremely important. Hives, nausea, angioedema. You're going to get this one a lot. Well, I don't know. I was just told that when I was 2. I had an allergy. You know why that's so horrible? I get that's another one of my soapboxes. I'll sit there and just tell the patient. That is forever in their chart. Forever that they cannot do a penicillin allergy. And if you go in and try to give it to them, it will give you this huge red ding, ding. And you have to do all this stuff to override it. So that's why when I have a parent that sits there and says, I think my baby's allergic to penicillin, I'll be like, really? Let's talk about this. Because all the major medical conditions that your baby could get, the first line treatment is a penicillin. So is your baby really allergic to penicillin? Well, no, she just spit it up one time. I'm serious, you have to do that because once you put it in there, they can't have it. I'm freaky about that. Health maintenance, that's just immunizations, preventative care measures. Yeah, I got a colonoscopy in 2015. I had a mammogram last year. That's what that is. Always put, if you can, the results of their tests that they had. If they know it, mammogram, normal, negative, whatever. Colonoscopy, no concerns found. You can do that. That's awesome. Whoops. Family history. Family history is always a big one where you start to get like into the weeds. Like, how far am I going here? Am I going to that 15th cousin twice removed bit? Usually I do mom, dad, grandparents, siblings. Like, that's where I, you know, people are going to throw out to you, yeah, I had this cousin, he lived in Ireland, and he, it's fine, just listen to him. Mom and dad, first degree relatives is a good general rule. Unless they tell you something that's really big. This is an interesting thing that we found when we just did the full HMPs with students. We had lots of students that would, you know, they'd be with a simulated patient, and the student would ask, so how's your husband's health? And I was like, why are y'all doing that? I think why they learned that and started doing it was maybe like in a mental, they must have had like a mental health lecture or something. Because it is important. Like if the person's presenting for like depression or anxiety and they're like a primary caregiver of somebody that's on hospice or death or whatever, I think they learned at some point that it's important to ask, like, you know, so your husband's ill. Tell me, you know, is he, you know. But they just assume that every time you ask, so how's your husband? They don't care about that. It has nothing to do with your patient's health. So you don't have to ask about, and it actually had that in the book specifically, but when I read it, I was like, oh, wish my students would have read this last year. You do not have to document spouse's medical history. It said with the caveat, unless, you know, they come in for genetic counseling for infertility issues, yeah, that's pretty important because they're coming together to make something. Family history, I just added this in. It's in the book, but it's really important. Always, always document. Don't discount like mental health, behavioral health type stuff when it comes to family history. Huge genetic component to substance abuse and addiction. Huge. As is mental health and psych disorders. If I have a patient that comes in with mental health stuff, anxiety, depression, bipolar, blah, 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 I always make sure in my family history box I turn it on. I'm like, anybody else dealt with something like this? Yep, my mom, she has horrible, she's a manic depressant. And, I mean, they'll just let it all out. You're like, that makes my diagnosis of you so much stronger. So don't ever discount those things. We always just think it's the hardcore diabetes, hypertension. Mental health is huge in family history, especially if they suicide. Because, you know, there is, they think, not genetic component to suicide, but that it can be familial. Like if mom did it, you're at a higher risk for committing suicide. So I document suicide as well. Touchy subject, but you have to do it. Psychosocial history, that is obviously... They say psychosocial. We usually say social history. That's the way it is in most EMRs. That's the way I do it. Social, guys, it's everything. You know the three biggies we always ask for social. What are they? Yeah, tobacco. And I'm a really bad speller, so just ignore me. That's one thing, you know, about documentation. I don't do it here because I get, you know, I don't have to do it. Not very many patients, but I was in family medicine. I saw the most patients there, and I was so behind in charting because I also taught the PA program. I actually purchased something called Drag and Dictate. I don't know if you've ever heard of this. It's a miracle. If you ever go out and practice and you're seeing tons of patients and you can't keep up with it, the charting aspects, there's a medical version of Drag and Dictate. You can buy it yourself and take it home. I had a little microphone that plugged into my home computer. It's gorgeous because it spells everything for you, and it spells it correctly. So if you say hydrochlorothiazide, it just pumps it right out. So invest in it. It's amazing. So tobacco, I always ask, because you'll say, have you ever smoked? Nope. Well, guess what? They quit last week, and they had smoked for 20 years, but they're going to say, no, because I really don't smoke. I haven't smoked for a week. I always ask. You will. They'll say it. I say past or current. And then when you say past, they'll say, oh yeah, I smoked from the time I was 18 till the time I was 45. Two packs a day. But if you asked them smoking status now, they'd say, no, I don't smoke. So I always ask past, current. And that's important, because if you had somebody come in with something lung, you kind of would want to know that, right? This is how I document alcohol. You can say ETOH. That's a little fancy way you document. And then I say illicit drug use, illicit or illegal. And then you could write out meth, smack. Does anybody even use that? What is smack really? What is that, cocaine?
Heroin.
Is it heroin? I should have known that. I was around in the, well, I was born in 70s, so I don't know when heroin was in the 60s. Okay. Let's see here. Social, another one I was going to say to you that's really important, and again, this is in your little book here, especially if someone comes in with like back problems, musculoskeletal, I always ask about their work. Now, what do you do for a living? Oh, I'm a paver, or I'm a carpenter. That's important. If they're on there freaking working like a dog, that's probably why they got, it just helps you. It just helps you make, feel better about your diagnosis. Always ask about that. And it has all that right there in that chart. If you ever don't know what to ask, it gives you some help right there. As does your Maxwell's. They have a full HP in there. Review systems. Again, we've already went over this. It's inventory of specific body systems designed to document any symptoms that the patient may be experiencing or has experienced. So unfortunately, when we make you go in and do that comprehensive H&P, you are going to have, not for this test, you're going to have that sheet memorized, that ROS sheet memorized. You can do it. I did it. Everybody before you did it. But you don't have to memorize for this test. I know there were some questions about that. And again, you know, when you're out practicing, you can have your cheat sheet there or whatever, but we just want to make you do it now, because that's our job. But the ROS is important just to get a feel, especially if they don't come in with any complaint. You know, just to get a feel for things that may be there, that they may have been experiencing that you wouldn't have otherwise known. And again, we document it by pertinent positives and pertinent negatives, like I told you the other day. So it's pertinent. How do you spell pertinent? P-E-R-T. I would never have gotten that one. That's how you document it. Like under cards, the cardiology section. Actually, most EMRs, it's awesome. It'll just have cardiology. You'll click on that box and it'll pull up all these, basically what's in the thing that I gave you, and you just click it.
If you're establishing care, do you have to review every single system?
Every system. But again, that's why it's considered a comprehensive history and physical. A SOAP note, nope. You're going to do what's focused. But H&P, yeah, technically you need to do it. And to bill, because you're going to get paid. You're going to get paid. For a comprehensive H&P, way higher than you would just a basic office visit. But in order to do a comprehensive H&P, they're going to tell you how many ROSs you technically have to hit. You have to do them all.
Can I ask a question?
So yes,
ma'am. In our book and on our other thing, it just says general, and then I experience general meaning for like your ROS.
Oh, general, okay. Yeah, I know exactly what that is. I can tell you, it's fever, chills, unexplained weight loss. Is it not in that sheet I gave you?
It probably is. Looking in the book.
No, that's what that means. Okay. Go to either in my slide or that one page. I gave you all a one-page document. I think it's fever, chills, night sweats, unexplained weight loss. Those are like general. Good question. Yeah, because you're right here, it just has nothing. And in fact, hold on just a second before I tell you a lie. Yep, here you go. Go to page 23. There's your review of systems. That's their version of review of systems. So for constitutional, they have constitutional general, same thing. Weight loss, weight gain, fatigue, weakness, fever, chills, and night sweats. So that's what they use. Does that make sense? They give you all their ROSs right there, what is there. Do you see that? Are books different?
It just says constitutional.
Yeah.
Let me see your book. Can I just look to make sure it's
constitutional?
This is the brand new one. It's the same.
Yeah,
okay.
Don't worry. Was that sheet that you were talking about? Is that on D2L?
I think I posted to D2L.
Yeah,
I'm
sure.
Oh, hey, I'm glad you actually brought that up. That's a really good point right there. If you ever feel like someone's cultural or religious belief system is going to play a part in their medical care, like Jehovah's Witness, they do not believe in blood products. I can't think of the other ones, but like, you know, for your spirit cash, you know, that's an example of this. That is absolutely important to document. Thank you for saying that out loud. So table 2-4 kind of gives you an idea of how to ask that stuff. But that would obviously be an important thing to document, right?
I mean, put that under social, or?
I personally would put it under their social. That's where I would stick it. Yeah, this is a great ROS right here. And again, you know, these are things I'm going to teach you in regard to, like, the art of interviewing a patient and how you do it. Patients are going to get annoyed with you when you ask these questions because it's a lot. And they're like, God dang, you just asked me that. So, like, let's say you do the family history, the social history, you'll do it again somewhat when you do your ROS. Like, there's a whole section on psych stuff, like emotional service, sleep service, substance abuse. They're like, you already asked me all that. You know, just explain to them why you're doing what you're doing. Just say, I understand. These are a lot of questions, and I know you're just going to be bored to tears. But I'm just doing it so I can take the best care I can of you. That's the way I tell patients when they get all up in the business with the ROS. You just got to do it. Okay. Oh, that's a good point. ROS, since you are doing a lot, I just say the last year. If they're a brand new patient, you don't want to run up from when they're 5 years old. Just say and you do it before you start getting into them, say in the last year. That's what I want you to think about in regard to this. Does everybody understand that? Physical examination, I am not going to introduce you to the components of a physical examination yet because it would just overwhelm you to tears and you don't have any medical conditions to match it up with, and we're going to do that later. So don't worry about that right now. But you will do a comprehensive physical examination, and that means every stinking thing that I'm going to give you in the physical exam, that we have a comprehensive one. You will get those components of that in each course, eyes and the heart, but at the end, we're going to make you walk into a room and do the whole physical exam from start to finish, and it's timed. It's timed. And I have a little check sheet that I sit there and I watch you do it. You're going to find your own way of doing your physical exam. What makes you comfortable, how you do it. Most of the time, though, this is where that whole systematic thing comes in. You want to do it from head to toe, usually. You don't want to be all down there checking the kneecap and then go up and look in the ear, and then because you will lose your rhythm. And once you are getting timed and graded, you have to have a rhythm and you have to be efficient, or you will never get through it. And I will teach you that. But it's usually a head-to-toe fashion. It just keeps people on track. These are the components of a physical exam. There are many different things that go under that physical exam. And how to document a normal physical exam. Let me look. Actually, in your book, it tells you all the components of the physical exam. It's on page 24 into 25. These are the things that they're telling you to note. We obviously teach you the physical examination skills to figure out these things. So listening to the heart, listening to the lungs. You have thus far gotten vital signs, which are listed there. So those are all the components. Laboratory diagnostic studies, we kind of already went over this. Document results of any studies, lab tests, radiographs, or other imaging studies. One thing that I do, lots of people don't do it. You need to do it, but it takes a lot of time. That's why people don't do it. If you order, like, let's say, a CBC on them, you need to technically write out the results of that CBC. It just makes for better care. Whoever sees them next can pick it up and look at it very quickly. Don't just say CBC normal or within normal limits, or you can somewhat write out. Write the numbers out. It's easy to cut and paste it in there. It's also something I do. If I have a patient that comes in, I do labs on them, and they had the same labs drawn like 6 months ago or whatever, I will actually write out my labs, and I'll put like the number for the white blood cell count, and I'll say compared to the white blood cell count that they got 6 months ago. It takes a lot of work, but you will look like a rock star. Because you're comparing it, because that's what we do a lot of times. Or we use labs to obviously diagnose, but also to follow treatment. Are your labs, are your lipids going in the right direction? Because I started you on a statin 3 months ago. So you need to put both those labs in there. A lot of people don't do that. You will get a chest x-ray. You will get a radiology report back. Document the radiology report. Or a lot of times you're going to have to read the x-ray yourself and go over to your chart and document what you see or what you don't see. So next, if you're following the example that they have on page 20, because I'm going to show you this first because this is the correct way, and then I'm going to tell you how I do my HMP. I don't follow it exactly like this, and I don't follow that way in my soap note, but I'm going to teach you this first. Because technically, I know why they're doing it. They're putting the lab data under objective. Because technically, it is objective, right? It's hardcore, solid facts. We know it to be true. I do not talk about my labs in my objective or in my physical exam, or at the end of my physical exam, which is what most people do. I actually have an assessment or a problem list. So I'll put like my ICD, cough, fever, whatever. Then I'll have my plan of care, and I do all my labs there, what my differential is. And basically the way I do it, I'm a number list person. I literally do it like this. And I'll show you some of my plans of care. I'll say one, and I'll say cough. Because that is going to match up with what I wrote in my assessment. And this is my plan of care. I'll say cough, and then I'll put a dash, and I write out everything about it. What I'm thinking, what I think's causing it, what I've ordered to rule it in or rule it out, what I'm going to order, what medication I started them on, every single thing there. My plan of care is usually really big, and I do it like this. That's how I do it. If I have it, because I'll do like legit what I know for a fact they are being diagnosed with only in my assessment. That's what I know for a fact. not my differential, because you don't code for differentials. You only code for what you know to be true. Like if someone did have a cough, I don't know. It could be asthma, it could be COPD, it could be lung cancer. I don't know that today. I'm not going to put lung cancer in the chart. I'm only going to send you out with cough. Whatever the ICD-10 is for that. But over in my plan of care, I'm going to have cough, blah, blah, blah. Differential includes asthma, COPD, malignancy. And then I'll even go into those. I'll say why I think it is or why I think it's not, and what I'm going to do to prove it is or is not. Does that make sense? It will. We'll do this over and over and over again till you are can do it in your sleep. But do you understand? Yes.
Like in your assessment, so say they have like several symptoms, would you also put like number one in the assessment to match number one cough, number one?
Sure you could. Sure you could. And again, please, please, please listen to me. This, you can do this any way you want to do that. That's the beauty of it. My job is to teach you one way to do it as a student so you're not all over the place. This is how I do it. But if you look on a chart, this is the way they normally teach people. And a lot of people do it this way. It's not wrong. They put the labs, they put the diagnostic results in the objective section under the physical exam. Okay, so problemless assessment differential diagnoses. And they have it according to this. Next. So you're always going to start with most severe problems first. I'm just looking at this. When you do an admit HMP, what you always do, like let's say they were coming to you for something bad or some symptom, whatever. This is an admit HMP. Or I'm sorry, a comprehensive HMP or an admit HMP. They're technically the same thing. So in your assessment box, you're going to start with listing what they're there for most acutely. So you would have, let's say it was cough. That's the only thing they came for, cough. But they've had hypertension and diabetes for the last 20 years. You have to list that in their assessment. You didn't diagnose them with it. They told you that. But you do that because you're going to attach a code to it, and it will forever be in their chart. So if they're with you at your practice, you know they are a diabetic. Does that make sense? So you put the thing that they're presenting with, and then you put chronic or comorbidities that they might have. Sorry, I'm getting crazy on this right here. And that's where you can also say controlled. Or, a good one, resolved. Don't let this overwhelm you. We'll do this over and over again. Plan of care. Plan of care is what it says. Everybody just says plan. I like plan of care. I had a geriatrician. He was family medicine board certified. He loved him. God, I wanted to work for him so bad. He taught me, he called it a plan of care. Because he's like, you're taking care of them. So I just adopted that. And every time I say it, someone, if they're, they'll be like, did you ever work with a geriatrician? I'm like, plan of care. That's what I use. Because it's your care plan. You can document additional studies or workup that you need, referrals, consultations. This is where you talk about your medications you're going to be prescribing and that you describe to them how to properly take the medication. You need to document that. You talk about non-pharmacological management, patient education. If you did smoking education, smoking cessation, you can actually document that and get paid more money. Say, spent 15 minutes with a patient going over smoking cessation, provided them with 1-800-QUIT and pamphlets. Patient wants an understanding, boom, you just got an extra, I don't know, $150. I'll teach you that. Disposition. Disposition is basically your last little sentence that says, advise patient to return to clinic in 48 hours, advise patient to follow up as needed. That's where you tell them what you're going to tell them to do regarding the follow up. You may not ever need to see them again until they need you. And the way I always document that, I just say, this is when you know you're getting lazy. It's not lazy, it's just time management. You've got to be efficient. I would just say, return to clinic as needed. RTCPRN. That's what I would document.
Okay.
So again, just real quick, that's your components of an HMP. Physical exam. So no, if you want to look, this is excellent. That's one thing I love about this book, and I wanted you to buy it. There are exercises in this book. I know it seems juvenile. Do them. It's amazing. The only way you're ever going to know if you're good or bad at something is if you test yourself. So there are these little exercises at the end. Practice them. Practice them. If you look on page 27, 28, and 29, there is a quote-unquote mock full HMP. That is what it would look like if you wrote it on a patient. It's a lot. It's a lot. And when you're a student, I make you handwrite them. In clinical rotations, I make you handwrite them. Only because I don't want you to cut and paste. Because you can cut and paste.
Oh, man.
I did not bring those.
Oh, you didn't?
No. But sit down. I got to hurry up. We got 10 minutes. Yes. No, you might. Sure. Like, let's say if you were internal medicine or cardiology and you were seeing Sally Sue for the very first time for uncontrolled hypertension. Absolutely. Yes, ma'am. It's usually if you see them for the first time ever, you do. Because you don't know anything about them. You got to get everything you know about them, right? Okay. Soap note. So soap note, nothing new here. We're just going to kind of start repeating ourselves. It's technically the same thing. This is chapter 5, is your soap note chapter. But yeah, that look at that example there. Sorry, I got off on it. Again, I know you already know this, because we did it yesterday. Soap note is subjective. Objective, assessment, plan, right? The soap note chapter, this is excellent, 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 excellent. Read it if you have not. I took the information from it. So again, this is the components of your soap note. Not that different than what we just did. It's pretty much all there. But now you're going to see this little nice word that says pertinent. Or focused. You're going to have to be able to do a focused soap note. Meaning you're going to walk in, let's say you're the one I like to always use because we did our last little comprehensive HMP with the second years and they missed this. Let's say it was a nosebleed. Let's say they came in with a nosebleed. You get the HPI, you get all that. But a lot of the students, when they would get to their review of systems, they didn't even at least start, if you're doing a focused now, focused review system, pertinent ROS. You can't go through all those. Start with the section that most closely correlates with the chief complaint. Does that make sense? This person had a nosebleed. They didn't even get to the heme one, the heme section. And I'm like, that, you know, is it a bleeding disorder? Do they have, you know. So start with the ROS that most closely relates to your chief complaint and then all the ones that would be associated with it. You don't have to go through all the ROS. You can't. You don't have time. Pertinent past medical history. Because again, I'm not going to lie. There are many times that I'm in clinic, I don't go through all that stuff. I don't go through your family history, your social history, you don't go through all that. If it's pertinent, then you do. But for the most part, if it's been filled out, now if it's blank, fill it in. But if it's filled out, you don't have to do it. You can quickly say, is everything, nothing's changed in your family history, has it? Or so you can do that. But you do not have to go through all that when you're doing a focused clinic visit. Like with the nosebleed, the students totally missed in family history. They just were like, mom, dad, anything? You have any, you know, hypertension, diabetes? The patient said no. And I said, this would be an instance when you would want to specifically drill the patient down. Has mom, dad, any family relative, any bleeding disorders? any issues with leukemia, malignancy. That's when you need to know diseases enough to know what to specifically ask in those that are pertinent. And the students were like, oh, I didn't think to ask. I'm like, yeah, because it's a nosebleed. You're trying to figure this out. Objective, the same as we, you know, your physical exam. Here it has laboratory diagnostic studies under that. Like I told you earlier, you do not have to put it there. I don't put it there in my note. I put mine in my plan. Assessment, and then plan. It's the exact same thing. So this is a little exercise. I want you to say, tell me if it's subjective or objective. The first one.
Subjective.
No.
Subjective.
Yeah, subjective, sorry. And that could be both, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're not
going to
say the right hand is
They might say that to you.
Well, isn't it the
other thing?
They
can see it, though.
Yeah.
It's that it's objective.
But you would document it really like that in your physical exam anyway. You would say, right hand is diffusely edematous.
Yeah.
Like, bullet point 5 is... Absolutely. That's you totally saying that. Last one is... Yes. Because they denied any allergy. They told you that. The third bullet point, that one, what about that one?
Subjective.
Right, because they're telling you. That wasn't a great exercise. Sorry about that. I was trying to be all smart, and that just crashed and burned. Right? We've already said this. Let me say it again. Test results, name the result, or name the test, give the results. I have within normal limits because I've done it before, but then again, I just told you not to do that. You can do that if it's everything, but if you have time, list out the numbers that you were, why did you order this? What were you even trying to look there for? So like if you thought somebody had like maybe a little skin infection or something, like a little cellulitis in the abscess formation, you wanted to order a CBC on them, but their white blood cell count was normal. At least give the number of the white blood cell count and say, per this, decreased concern for infection. At least do that number. And again, change from previous lab. So if it's, you want to compare your labs. Yes, ma'am.
If you order a bunch of labs and they're all normal and you have some values that are abnormal, could you say everything's within normal limits except for these values?
Yes, you can. And I've done that before. Sure. Great. Yes, good job. Assessment, we've already said this. First, you just do an order of importance. So first one is obviously if they presented with something, you list that out. And then comorbidities or medical conditions they might already have, you want to list those out as well. But they go at the end. An ICD-10 code is going to pop up for you. You don't have to label it. It does it for you and your EMR. This is just some extra stuff, some extra pearls. Nothing new here. It's just basically what you think could potentially be going on. You know they have a cough, and you know they have wheezing, but you don't know if it's COPD. You don't know if it's asthma. You don't know if it's a restrictive lung disease. You don't know if it's a malignancy. It could be any of those things, and I'm going to say that out loud, but I'm also going to say and document why I either think it is or it isn't those things. Differential diagnosis is important. I put in that last little bullet point. I thought it was kind of cool, and I saw that in this book. You can say rule out. They taught or showed in there that you can actually document that. So you can say rule out, to R-O, and how you're going to rule it out. This is how they showed to document a differential diagnosis. And I actually kind of like this. I've never done it this way before, but you could. This is kind of cool. The only thing, like, so for calf pain, let's say the patient had calf pain, they came in with that. So you need to rule out DVT, cellulitis, muscle strain. And again, you don't always have to rule stuff out by ordering a test or blood, I mean, you don't have to. You can talk about, per the HPI, the physical exam findings, the vital signs, I do not feel it's consistent with a DBT. Does that make sense? But like I told you, if you document something on your differential, you have to tell why it's not. You can't just document and then not address it. These are just some examples. Left lower quadrant pain, because that's what they came in with. It could be diverticulosis, it could be ovarian cyst, and it could be a nephrolithiasis, so a kidney stone. I'm going to rule those three things out. Now that one I probably would. I'd get a transvaginal ultrasound, and I'd get a CT scan of the abdomen and pelvis. Right, great, toe pain, because those are also legit ICD-10 codes. Right, great, toe pain is an ICD-10 code. You're going to rule out gout, arthritis, and fracture. So you'd order a uric acid. You would get an x-ray of the foot. You'd get those results back, and you would write out uric acid level. Or you could say uric acid level is not consistent with gout, acute gout flare-up. X-ray shows no fractures. X-ray shows degenerative changes consistent with arthritis. There you go. You just put a differential and you just told why you think it is what it is. Yes?
So, like, should you have so many things on your differential? Because if you don't think it's a DVT because of, you know, there's blood pressure and things like that, should you even put it in the chart?
No, and that's actually a very good point. You don't always have to have differentials. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, god dang, yeah. You don't like, if it's, there are many things that are going to come into you, and you're going to be like, I absolutely, you have a UTI, man. You have a sore throat. You have strep throat. You have a sinusitis. You have a, I don't know, I'm just trying to, pneumonia. Those are even kind of bad ones. But there are going to be things. A little kid comes in with an abscess. You're going to get them all the time. Oddly enough, kids get them all the time. You know that's an abscess. Yes, you do not have to have a differential. I know what this is. This is how I figured it out, and this is how I'm going to treat your UTI. I got a dipstick on you. You have positive nitrites, positive Lucas, blood in your stool, or blood in your urine. Here's some Macrobid. End of story. When you walked out of the room to order your urine, and your urine culture and sensitivity, you didn't attach UTI. You attached to it dysuria, which is burning in the urine, urinary frequency, urinary hesitancy, symptoms of UTI, and you'll learn all that. It shoots to the lab, they run it, spin it down, pops back to you, you get your results, usually within about 15 minutes, not the culture and sensitivity, it comes down the line a couple days. 15 minutes, it comes back to you, you see it, you walk in the room, you tell the patient, you have a UTI. You have a cystitis, you have acute cystitis. Let me give you some Macrobid. Then you walk out of that room, you go do that chart later on, then you put UTI on that chart. You can put urinary acute cystitis, acute urinary tract infection. No differential, no other things. If I didn't put UTI when I walked out of the room, that's how it was at my clinic. I know everybody's different. Dr. Bonetta one day was like, well, when you ordered a CT scan, I would actually put, and it's the TIA. I'm like, really? Did you know it was a TIA? Transient ischemic attack. But I know in some offices, like internal medicine, they will put the actual diagnoses. I did not do that at my clinic. They wouldn't actually pay for labs if you did that sometimes. You had to put the symptom or the complaint or sign. You could put a sign also. Elevated blood pressure, that's a sign. You do not have to have a differential. Absolutely. You can only have one differential. That's okay too. You don't have 3, 4, 10, just one. One's good enough. Plan, we already went over this. You know, what are you going to do for them? Same stuff. Any questions? I know that's kind of a repeat of yesterday, but the more you see something, the better it is going to stick.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
So if the test comes back negative for a UTI, what would you tag it with so it still gets paid for but it doesn't come back positive?
You could actually put it, keep it on there, just urea.
Okay.
It's going to get paid by symptoms, signs, things are telling you. Because you will get UAs back sometimes that do not show an infection. But like a big one, this is the one we ran into all the time. Women will come in saying she's pregnant. You want to order a test on them. What do you even put on that? We count a lot. This is the one where you just order tests to get stuff covered. They may not even have a missed period yet. But the way we would get it covered at OU Family Medicine, then we would put amenorrhea. So that's the fancy word for missed period. They may not even have a missed period yet. We would just put amenorrhea. They would come back, they were pregnant. They would still cover it though. You always have to attach something to a lab, to a chest x-ray, to a CT scan, to a pulmonary function test. Actually, another example, when I was at OU Family Medicine, in order to order and get paid a pulmonary function test, they had very, very specific codes that you had to put with it. Like nocturnal cough was one, wheezing, seasonal out. There was certain things that you had to put on it to get it covered. Anyway, that's it. Any other questions, guys? Good questions. Very good questions.